talking about Java generics, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's completely kind of dependent, was done by Java. So I mean, how Scala type system and generics are interrelated or connected? What is the relationship between these two?
Yeah, generics are just a concept. Like type system is a programming. There are multiple concepts in a type system. Okay, for building a generics. Okay, so for there, because the reason of type system is the runtime issues. Some of the issues which we can resolve at compile time. So why would worry about runtime? So this is the main reason of type system, because delegate those work, delegate some of the issues to the compiler, which validate, bro, is it a good or a not. Like the much more simple example is our data types. We have an int data type, okay, int equals to 4. Like in the JavaScript, there is no data type. If we are assigning some data, some values to some variable, and we are expecting, or suppose we are parsing those values, the number values into string, but that is a int value. At runtime, we are getting the error. If we solve that kind of issue at compile time, so in that way, type system come into the picture. We will see there are multiple ways of type system. There are strong type system, weak type system. What are those type systems? Just for an introduction or for a briefing perspective as well.
Okay, but that means like the generics are also used to provide this kind of
Yes, generics are you are right. Generics are used to prevent those issues which are more common and generated at a runtime.
Right, right. So in that case, like, what is the role of Scala type system?
Scala type system perform the same work, but itself provide a further functionality as well. There are which Java generics has not.
Java sophisticated. Maybe we'll see later, but abhi we don't have most context.
Java generics is not much powerful than a Scala type system. Scala type system, you can build a program using type level programming. Type level programming is a different concept, but type level programming said, if your program is compiled, that means at runtime you never get an error. Yeah, exceptions at runtime. You never get an exception at runtime if your program is compiled.
There will be some runtime exceptions. There can be some runtime exceptions.
If you are doing type level programming, there is 99% chances you didn't get any runtime exception.
And like the type level programming is kind of paradigm or like kind of a separate library or like what is it?
This is not a paradigm. This is a way for developing a program. Type level programming means your program is compiled. At compile time, the common problems, 80%, the 80% or 90% issues check at compile time.
So, in the starting, you compared type level programming with functional programming.
Type level programming is a different. Type system is different. Type system is different. The roadmap is kind of type system. Type system has a two branches, maybe multiple branches, but what I know, there's a two branches. Functional programming. Functional programming means type system help us to implement the functional programming. Type system help us to implement functional programming. That we will see in our next workshop, not today. But yes, it is possible. And next branch is type level programming.
So this is another paradigm.
Not a paradigm, it is a way. The paradigm is the same. We are writing classes, we are writing functions. But type level programming is, it ensures your data, your concept is checked at compile time. Maybe we will discuss that type level programming maybe some other day, not today. Because if you have an idea about shapeless in Scala, shapeless is a type level program. If you are developing a program using shapeless, that means you are doing type level programming.
So it's kind of a library, more like a library.
Shapeless is a library. For a Scala, shapeless is a library which helps us to building it, writing a type level programs. But some of the Scala has some of the features. Without shapeless, you can also write type level program without shapeless. Even we have no idea what are those features, but there are.
Yeah, but like, there are some consequences of type level programming.
Yes. 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 There are consequences. Yeah. Everything has their own advantages and disadvantages. A type level programming set, if your program is compiled at runtime, you are not getting any error. But there are consequences. Yes, you are right.
But
there are some advantages and disadvantages as well.
I mean, but this statement, right? So once your program is compiled, you will never get a runtime exception. I mean, how cool it is? Because like there are some cases like divide by zero exception. I mean, can we check it out?
Yeah, these all things are actually handled at runtime. Oh, sorry, compile time. There are multiple ways for handling these kinds of issues. These types of issues. By using type level system, there are, but it depends which way we want to implement.
Okay, so that is like the Scala type system is kind of wrapper over Java generics, and it provides.
Java generics is a different. Generics is a concept.
Okay.
Java implement that concept, and Scala implement that concept, and many other languages as well.
Okay.
Generics is a concept. Java implement, Scala implement, and many other languages as well. But Java implement that generics part like this much. But Scala implement the generic part like this much. So this depends on the programming language implementation.
Why
will
Scala focus so much on the
generic part? The reason is, as we already discussed, Scala is a functional programming language also. So for implementing that functional part, there is a two way, entities or type system. So Scala preferred type system.
So I'll probably give a context. I was hearing one lecture. It was me was that if the language type system is very sophisticated, then there are some concepts from mathematics, which is a category theory concept, which you can implement using that sophisticated type system. We don't know, but the thing is that the purpose of making the type system so sophisticated is so that you can express those higher level constructs directly.
So
maybe we will see this in our further slides as well.
You are saying if there is a runtime exception, if we are doing a type system programming, and it's given in the error at the compile time. So if there is a method like we are dividing something, so it doesn't have the value at that time, then how it is known that okay, we get in the runtime exception?
But there are ways.
In the ways.
Like Scala has a way required.
So
you can add that clause there.
Okay, it is
some checks to provide
handle those kinds
of runtime exceptions. Like there is some arithmetic exception that will we will get at runtime.
Yes.
Like by dividing by zero, then we will always check whether the number
you can say that type level programming like that, work like that.
Because at the end,
every program is converted into the bytecode.
No,
at the end.
So I'll say something. So the big idea of functional programming is that exception can program halt them. But it says that you treat the exception values as normal program values which your program can handle itself. So that is the whole point why functions library was designed. For example, aapne bola ki 0 se divide kare, exception throw kare. So your program handles that and then the return time becomes an option of double. So function total ho gaya. Double se option of double pe ja raha hai. So agar 0 pe bhi aata hai, the program will internally.
But sometimes we don't know na, except ki it is 0 or we don't
know. You will handle
it from other functions.
Maybe what we can do. For a type level programming, the quick discussion about type level programming we will do at the lunchtime.
Okay.
So, because today we are not focusing on type level programming.
At least like the AI thing.
Because today we are not focusing on type level programming, we are focusing on a generic Scala type system. Okay? Maybe in our next workshop, if we will discuss about type level programming, then definitely we will groom our brains as well. But not today. So let's start with the module 1. Module 1 agenda is what are types? Types in Scala. Custom types, parameterized types, what is variance, subtyping, type of variance, and function variance. Okay? So, what are types? The beautiful definition by Heather Miller. A type can be thought of as a category that a value, typically at a runtime, can fall into. For example, the number 12 would have a type in and its corresponding value would be 12. So, first of all, before a type, there are values. Like in this example, there are, we have a what is category? Category means a group of some elements. In the layman term, a group. In the layman term, a group. Today we have a group of this circle is a kind of a group, and this group have a different types of element. While these elements has some different type of behaviors. Okay, these are values. There are different values, but if we wrap these values into this type, so a type means it. A type itself is a category because it a single type like int is a type, okay, and but int contains n number of elements. String is a type. String contain n number of elements. These all concepts are come from the mathematics. So in the mathematics there are sets. So somehow they are difficult to implement those types of set. Whatever their problem is, I have no idea. But because of their limitation, they develop their types. From the types, they associated or intersect whatever they want. Based on types, they actually create the categories. Like in a programming language, we have an int, double. These are our categories, and these categories contain n number of values. If we see this diagram, like values are like this way, types are like this. We have an n number of values, but types are less than values because 2 and 3 are different values. But they belong to the same type.
So you cannot say this surely because whatever type has only one value, then the number of type and the number of values same. This cannot be said as a generalization. The number of values will always be greater than the number of types.
Number of values always be greater than number of types. Always be greater.
You are saying an universal set. Like all the types we have will always be less than all the values we have in all the combined types.
If we see this diagram, we have no idea what are the values are there. Maybe like today we have 86, 7.65, then one string and one a character. So, but like in this diagram, we have a double. This double contains many double values, but double is a single.
So I think just to use the right terminology, I would not say double contains 11.65. I would say that
double is a category, and in this category there are n number of elements.
So I actually once I was doing that function programming for Coursera. So there Martins had this very formal definition which was given by another mathematician about what is the meaning of type. So the formal definition that they gave is that if there is some property px which is provable upon an object of type X, then it will be provable on all objects of type, whatever type it is. So, they define whether something belongs to a type or not on the basis of some property which is provable about the object. So, if there is a type mein kuch objects hai, to kuch ek property which is sabke upar provable hogi. Then we can say that these all objects are in this type.
That's what I said. Not all objects, but if we talk into the way of raw values, Raw values mean any type. Raw value is a kind of infinity. We have no idea. But for the type, we have some idea. For the raw values, we have no idea. Like here, in this category, we have no idea how many values are in this category. But with the type, we have some idea. Suppose in this diagram, we have 11.65, 11.66, 11.67, 11.68. N number of values. But that values are associated with this double type. So that's why I use this diagram. Values are of this level, but for types we have some idea.
So let's
for values we have some types. Every value is somehow every value is associated with one type, definitely. This is proved. But one type contain n number of values. It's okay. It's okay.
But still, number of values is printed in number of.
But what if there is some type which
basically n doesn't mean there is infinity. N means 0 up to n. N can be anything. N can also be 0. N can also be 1. N can also be 2. N is also always a generic number.
Yes.
In mathematics, we always say n. Then we also limit a condition like n will be greater than this and it will be bounded by this.
Okay. So that's why values on this level, types on this level, and in next workshop we will see another thing is in this level, but not today.
So that's basically the categorization of types as well.
Yes. So simplify type as a category or set contains infinite values. We have no idea if a single type contains how many values. Every value has its own type. Every value has its own type, and one type contains multiple values. Single type contains multiple values. Okay? Type disciplines. So language can be categorized into at least four camps based on how deeply or whether or not the language design embeds types. Like a language can be statically typed versus dynamically typed, or strong versus weak types. Okay? Statically typed languages, which can have strong or weak typing, distinguish two phases, compile time and runtime. Most of the static type languages have a two phases, compile time and runtime. Dynamic languages, which can also have a strong or a weak typing, don't have such a distinction. Like there is no compile time and runtime, there is just like only runtime. Okay. Now, what is strong type static type languages? At compile time, ensure that certain values with a specified type like int is correctly used through the program, so that at runtime nothing else other than specified type can be held that memory location. Like if we are declaring some variable, okay, so the language is strong statically typed. If we are declaring some variable and at runtime that variable is associated with those types in which type we declared, like we are at programming type, we declare variable as an int. At runtime, that variable is definitely as an int. There is no backdoor entry like memory allocation or something else. We change the value of those memory. Like if we are running our application, we are declaring some variable in memory. Just assume there is some bucket. The variable reserve their memory as a bucket, and that bucket is a type of int. Okay, but there is but statically typed language ensure at runtime that int type of bucket never going to be changed. That int type of bucket never going to be a string type of bucket. Like Scala and Java and other languages support strong static type languages. Okay, now weak static type languages. Compile time ensure that certain value of the specific type is correctly used throughout the program. But runtime, you can change the value of the specific type memory allocation, like C. By using C, we have a pointers, whatever we have, malloc, calloc. There are multiple things in a C. But at runtime, with the C, we can change the type of bucket within a memory. Like at the compile time, we decided this variable contains only int value, but at runtime we replace that those values by using string or by double. So those languages are called. Can do that. It is possible. This is possible in a C. You easily manipulate the memory within a C language.
How can you contain the reference of type, character type, or type value?
Because C, by using C language, you can deal with memory directly.
Yeah, I can.
But we have an address of that variable. We can manipulate that variable easily.
So basically, you're like.
We have a memory address. Is it possible to get an address of variable in a C? If you directly access those address. Then you can easily manipulate the memory.
Yeah,
yes,
in C, like
union, we have in union there are two or three types. In union, I guess we get the memory for the type which has the maximum size. Like for int or char, the more memory it will contain. Like for int types, it will have more memory. So it will occupy the memory size for an int, and it can always. Can also contain a character. That's what you're talking about.
That's character. Character is just a ASCII value, nothing else.
But
you can change that type value with some other values. Double, string, I don't know.
That is possible.
In JavaScript,
I mean,
in Java, I'm deadly sure this is not possible.
In JavaScript. Yeah.
JavaScript is possible, but in C this is also possible. So that's why C is also called.
What is the type of a functor, right? You can point by the
location.
But you will always have a type
of that pointer. Like
int pointer, string pointer,
and obviously
int pointer.
And you are saying
that
for
any
union, you can say that like there is a union type, and in union there are three types: int, character, and some other type, like array type. So that array type, like if we have array of string, it will have 10 blocks, array of 10 sizes.
Mm-hmm.
Then it will contain the size for 10 integer types in memory.
Mm-hmm.
So in that memory, you can also contain an array or string or a character.
Okay.
So that can be manipulated like that. In union,
maybe in that way they said, like in a string, you can manipulate the memory. Because I have no experience with the C memory this whatever it is, memory manipulation, but it is possible in a C language. That's what I know. But C is a statically typed language, but C has its weakness also.
Is there any other example other than C?
Weak static type means we can change
the value at runtime. Like in a Java or Scala, this is not possible. That we aren't sure. This is not possible. But in a C, it is possible because most of the writers.
I never experimented that part. Does it support explicit type changing in the C?
Java and Scala. Explicit typecasting we can do with the Java and Scala as well.
So what if I want to read an integer as a string? I mean,
I don't know.
I think we can
explore this one later on.
But if we
move forward, then strong dynamic type language. They check correctness of runtime, preventing one of calling a method defined as string on that or an int. Like Python. Python is a dynamic language, but it's a strongly dynamic type language. If you assign a variable with an int value, in the after that declaration, you can't change that int to the string. in a Python. So that's why Python is a strongly dynamic type language. If we declare some variable with an int value, and moving forward we are trying to manipulate that variable, int variable, to the string, this is not possible in a Python. So this is called dynamic, strong dynamic type language. Can't, because Python only interpret the program. There is no compilation phase. There is only a runtime phase. So that's why those languages are called dynamic languages.
And it is similar with JavaScript.
But in JavaScript you can. JavaScript is not a. JavaScript is a dynamic language, but it is not a strong typed language.
So
like it is in a weak dynamic type category. These languages provide no way for the programmer to write an arbitrary memory location. It allows user to directly manipulate memory, example like assembly, and as Randhir said, JavaScript, and there are more. Okay, so the whole languages are categorized into some of the type system category, and some of their disciplines like strongly or weakly dynamic language, or strongly or weakly static type language. Okay, so types in Scala. So this is just as we all are familiar with the Scala basic type structure. Like we have any other two branches, anywhere and anywhere, int, long, within a anywhere branch, and classes or our custom classes are from any ref branch. And on the bottom types we have a nothing. Nothing is actually a subclass for every anywhere and any ref, but null is a subclass of only any ref. Because of what is the reason? Anyone knows why null is not a subclass of any ref? Oh, sorry, anywhere. So anyone have an idea?
Huh?
Null is not a subclass of anywhere category. Why? Value में कभी नहीं. Why value doesn't contain a null? That's what I want.
So in anywhere, there must always have a value, but null doesn't have value.
Value means which value? But as we know, like all things are classes. So why? What I understand, or what I feel, the reason is while we are compiling our Scala code, it converts into the Java byte. And we are familiar with these int, long actually converted into the Java primitives. So for a primitives, there is no way to assign a null values. Get my point? So this is the reason. What I will. Yes, in the primitive you can't assign the null values.
Not even to a type of integer. But I think you can do that.
You can do with primitive wrappers, not primitive types. Those primitives are just kind of a directory memory location.
Java में तो जो primitives हैं, दास में जाते तो wrapper.
Never say this line again. We will discuss that often, but never say this line again. Ki primitive converted into the wrappers. Never, 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 ever.
No.
Auto-boxing is different concept, but just forget about it. Primitives are converted into the wrapper. Okay?
So basically what happens is if they have different expression, then you give a, when you say that you assign something, you can define it as a particular, you create an object of type and then set value as it. The same thing happens, it's just that it is both the most scala make up it is trick in Scala, right? So it is like a trick in Java. Where it that you can assign a primitive to a wrapper class, but actually what happens is it creates an instance of the wrapper class and then set that line.
Under the hood, it actually creates a new something like that. That. Okay. Never forget about to quit this session. This hashtag and tag non-speak and singer meet. While you are tweeting. So please honestly, whoever tweet this session, pick this chocolate. Okay.
One question.
Yeah.
So what is the difference between nothing and none?
Nothing and none?
None.
None, N-O-N-E.
Optional value.
None is a type. None is a class. None is a custom type.
Custom type.
None is hierarchy of. None is a subclass of option. None never introduced like in this. Even nothing is a subclass of none. Please avoid chit chat. You enjoy your chocolate, but avoid chit chat.
So I mean, how is nothing represented? What is it, a value or kind of a special memory location?
Nothing is a kind of a tag. You never instance nothing directly. You never ever do instantiate nothing directly. There are reason for introduce nothing. The reason is a functional programming also. Because in a Scala, everything is an expression. Statements are expressions. Even like in a Java, we have a if is a statement, switch is a statement, throw new exception is a statement. But in a Scala, everything is an exception. Sorry, everything is an expression. So you never directly instantiate nothing. Because nothing is a kind of a trick. Like the most common and major example of nothing is throw new exception. Throw means we are actually break our program flow. But throw is an expression, not a statement. If your method return, if your method trying to throw something, that function is returning some values like maybe there is a method. Okay, or we can try with wrapper. We can try on wrapper. Okay, Scala. Is it visible? Okay, dev method. Okay. Why this compile? Because throw new exception is an expression. It returns, throw returns nothing. As we know, nothing is a subclass of any type. Any type means every type, like anyval, the types which are within a anyval branch or a anyref branch. Nothing is a supermost subclass of every type. So that's why this program is run. So that's why this method is compiled. Because nothing is a subclass of int as well. In a Java, this is not possible. So this is the reason why Scala required this nothing type and play this trick under the hood. It's an expression. Throw new exception is an expression.
But I mean, if it is an exception, then it should return something. Like
yeah, it is returning something. Throw new exception is returning nothing. It is returning nothing. Nothing is a subclass of int. It is possible to declare covariant return types. that we will see in our later on slides.
Okay, but if throw new exception is not returning anything, I mean in the hierarchy of functions, I mean how we are getting the expression at the.
But it is returning, na? Throw keyword in Scala definitely returning nothing. Yeah, throw keyword, you can say throw is an expression while compiler sees like there is a throw new exception, that means this method returning this expression throw expression returning nothing.
But like how we differentiate between multiple exceptions, how that happens?
The trick is throw keyword. If we are using the throw keyword, that means that keyword or whatever internally it may be throw is, I have no idea. Honestly, I have no idea what actually throw is, but for me it is a keyword, and if we are using throw, that means it automatically returning nothing, and throw says I required this new exception. I always required new exception. I always required a throwable hierarchy. We are not able to throw any new user class here.
New user class, but I can throw my custom exception.
You can throw custom, but that your custom exception is also subclass of exception.
Right.
So these are the compile time checks, okay. Compiler verifying.
Okay, but my query is to know like how this differentiation happens, right? Because at the starting, I will be able to figure out like which kind of exception it is. It's not safe for me, so that I can say like it is always returning nothing kind of thing. For
compiling, like why we need to create a pure function. Pure function means every method returns something. So if this throw exception is a kind of break the method rules, so it is not possible to implement functional programming in Scala. It is not possible. So that's why Scala play this trick. If we are using throw, it actually under the hood returning something, and that something is nothing. We will discuss this offline. We will discuss. Actually,
yeah.
I am sure you are confused with something else.
Yeah.
But we will discuss this offline.
Right. I mean, this statement, right? If we are returning nothing,
it's
then how we are able to figure out like which kind of exception? I mean, that is a bit confusing for me. So we can discuss.
We will discuss offline. This we will discuss offline. Okay. So, what are custom types? There are two ways to defining a custom type. One is a class or trait, and second is a defined type number, is a type keyword. Like here, we have a class. How we can define a custom type? We have a class, and another way we are defining a type keyword. These are called the custom types. Okay, a name or a name type. Custom types is further contains a two way, name type, and name type contains further two ways, class, traits, and this type keyword. And combined types express types by combining existing types like compound type, refined type, like here. Like if we are, as we know, keyword mixing, if we mix some type with some other type, this is a kind of, this is called compound type. Okay, defined type, there is a defined, but not here. Defined type is a different thing.
What is the use case of this thing?
Yes, there is a use case, but today we are not discussing this combined type. Our main focus is on core concept of type system. Definitely we will go advanced feature of type system in our next workshop, but today we are just focusing on this core feature. So what are parameterized type? Same as generic types in Java. Generic types is a generic class or an interface that is parameterized over types, like here. We all are familiar with this kind of a syntax. We will see later on how we are declaring these generic types and what are the permutation combination by using these generic types. Okay, so these are called a parameterized type. Okay, So another thing which I want to share with you, some of the keywords which, not a keyword, from the terminologies which most of the time by using with the Scala type system, like the first terminology is type ascription. What is type ascription? So the type ascription means, like we know, like Scala type inference is really a powerful feature. So if we are defining a variable with desired type, and this way is called, this is called type ascription. If a variable defined with the specified type, like this variable is of thing type, that means here we are the terminology here we are using called type ascription. Explicitly providing a type. Okay, so why actually I am trying to figure out some of the terminologies which they are most of the time they are using in the blogs or some other places. So whenever we will go for further for reading, we are not confused with those terminology. I'll try my best, but if you have some of the knowledge, if you have some other inputs, please share within the session. Okay. Now, like as we know, parameterized type. So there is a most of the time while we are reading about the Java Scala type system, the terminology which mostly used the terminology is called a type constructor. Why I am taking this example? Because every time while I reading about the type constructor, I am confused. So that's why, for my reference, maybe if someone confused with the type constructor terminology, I want to share this with you as well. First of all, as we know, like if we see here, as we know, we are creating a custom type. Animal is our custom type. Animal is a type, okay, and collection is a type, okay. And here we have a stack. Stack is a further type. But if a type contains these brackets with some parameters, or a parameter that we call parameterized type, that is a different type. Like if we see in this example here, here we have animal, and bowl is our parameterized type, and we have further apple, orange, and kiwi. Okay. Now I am creating a bowl instance with apple, bowl instance with orange. That means now we have a bowl of apple, bowl of orange. This bowl of apple is different from bowl of orange. Maybe the outer wrapper is same, but the inner values is different. So if we talk about generics, if we ever seen these parameterized values or parameterized examples or parameterized code, that means this type and this type is different. Like int, double, float is a different type. Here bowl apple, bowl apple, both are different types. Okay. So type constructor means a type, like by using parameterized type, we are creating a new type by using apple and orange. With the ball of apple, with the ball of orange, we are creating a new type. So type constructor means a type, a constructor which helps to construct the type. Like a class contains a constructor parameter. A class contains a constructor parameter, and if we are passing constructor parameter for creating an object, we are creating a new type. But animal, yeah, object is a new, but type animal, animal. But that object is associated with the animal type. So like same as a like class, we have a same way for creating a type parameterization. Like this brackets is a kind of constructor, type of kind of a constructor. If we are passing some type within this bracket, we are creating a new type. So these brackets are called a type constructor, the constructor which is used to create a new type. Okay.
We have multiple types.
Like here, bowl, T, V. Yes, yes, we can. Okay. Let's move on. So parameterized types can interact with the type checking by adding or relaxing constraints on the type parameter. There are two types of constraints, variance and bounds. So while we are designing our parameterized type classes, there we can apply some constraints as well. And they have some constraints, but there are two way for applying the constraints. One is variance and second is bound. Okay. So first of all, why this parameterized? So let's take an example. Why we require this parameterized type? Why there is a need of type constructors? Why there is need of generics? So I have a small case study. I am not sure how much this case study is a good. The case study is based on the rise of superheroes, because I am a fan of superheroes, Marvel on DC as well. Actually, every superhero is my favorite. So we have some hierarchy as well. Yes, I lost the hierarchy page. Okay. So superheroes chapter one. What is chapter? So we love the world where the superheroes, where there are superheroes that fight for justice and humanity. But most of the superheroes have a common thing like one sad story, one emotional dialogue, powers, one like a tower where they communicate each other. And so let's build the hierarchy of superheroes and the common things like this. Like we have a superheroes and they are Marvel and DC, and Marvel has a Hulk is a Marvel and Doctor Strange, and Superman is under DC and Batman. Okay. So let's build this. So this code is visible to all of you. This code is visible to all of you? No. Okay. Now is it visible? So as per diagram, I am creating a superhero class which contains a team, and a abstract class Marvel which extends superhero, and Doctor Strange and Hulk which extend Marvels, and DC, Batman, Flash extends DC. So anyone have any issue with this hierarchy? Any confusion?
Yeah, I mean, according to my Batman, not a type.
Just a minute, actually.
There can only be one pattern. Single type. Has to be case object.
Just a minute, yeah. I just want to silent my mobile. Okay, so yeah.
So that precision might be an object. And Batman and Flash, they should be in kind of objects.
Batman and Flash.
Yes, in
Batman is not a class. Yeah. Class of
multiple.
They can only be one Batman.
Let's imagine. But we have a multiple movies of Batman, na?
Acha.
That's why the that.
Multiverse.
Yes. Multiple dimensions are there.
So we are
creating an object of Batman and Hulk. So this is a common method 5, which takes a parameter as a superhero, and by using Batman we are calling with Batman, we are calling with Hulk, and everything is running fine. As you can see in so it takes some time for compiling the code. Yes, it compiles, and if we are calling this Hulk, the fight with the Batman, fight with the Hulk, and we are successfully print this.
But who is fighting here?
But whoever is fighting, I have no idea whoever fighting is, but yeah, there is a method. Just pass a superhero and they start fighting. Or they are ready for fighting. Okay, now what are the problems without genetics? As you can see, we have a class tower which contains a, which accepts a parameter like a superhero and toString. This is a tower of superhero team, whatever the team name is. And if someone say help me, so it returns the superhero. Okay, now I'm creating a tower of Batman, tower of Hulk. So I'm calling this help me and help me. So while we are calling to the tower, and this returns we are Batman and Hulk, but here we are lost some information. We are returning the superhero, but which type of superhero is? If we see, which type of superhero is? I want to call to the Batman, but somehow Flash comes in.
So,
you mean
to say like we have one class tower, which is
in tower there is multiple heroes,
but I want to call Batman only because Joker attacks. Joker attacks. I want to call Batman, but I have no idea which superheroes comes in.
In this tower, there.
But there is Justice League.
You have to call the tower with Batman.
Yeah, I am calling the tower with Batman. But my reference have no idea which type of superhero will come. Maybe it is a Batman. No. At run time, it returns a Batman. But currently, I have no idea which superhero is returned. I have an idea. There is some superhero which helped me. But I have no idea which superhero is. Batman, Flash, or I have no idea. Okay, so how we can resolve these kinds of issue with the generics?
In this case, the tower which only will have Batman. So if you call on the tower which contains Batman, then you will always get Batman.
But at runtime, I have an idea.
Compile time, you also know which tower to call.
Okay, so suppose if I am doing something like this. As instance of Flash. Compile time, I have no idea.
But you are calling the tower, the Justice League tower. The Justice League tower,
yes,
is
I am
the only Batman here in your code. So,
this is just takes an example. So if I am doing something like this, because it returns the superheroes only, and I have no idea which type of superheroes. By mistake, I actually add this as instance of Flash here, and at runtime, I am getting the error. I am getting the exceptions.
Basically, what I am trying to say here is, you are calling the tower, forget the superheroes, the collection in which only Batman, there will be only one element, which is Batman, which the user has. The developer has written the code. Developer must know which tower has Batman.
But tower is a third party library. Sorry, I have no idea.
So it is only taking one input. If there are multiple out inputs, then there will be ability which superhero will return.
So if I want to use specific Batman's property, not superhero have some generic value like team. But Batman itself has some own properties. For that, we need to convert that object into the specific type.
So, Anuj, I think the problem here is like the data type within that tower case plus that superhero, not specific to Batman.
Superhero
or
and
like,
while I'm calling. But while I'm using help me, this superhero is. There are some superhero come for help me, but I have no idea which type of superhero is.
I mean, technically we cannot be sure about it, right? So the case class is superhero, not Batman or Hulk.
we are sure, but we cannot use that for something. Like Batman ke paas speciality hai, but we use nahi kar sakte.
Maybe tower is some third party library, you are passing Batman and that tower, but tower is a kind of singleton object, currently it contains superhero, you are passing Batman,
some
we have no idea, so how can we resolve that kind of problem by using generics? Like if this tower contains parameterized type, and while I am calling help me, at that time I am easily identified, like I am passing tower of bat, tower 2 of bat, tower 2 of, now it returns tower 2 of Batman specific, tower 2 of Hulk specific, and if I am calling help me, it returns Batman specifically, Batman specifically, Hulk. Okay, this is one of the feature or one of the power of type system. There is no need to cast the super type into any the subtype which may be possible. We are getting exception at runtime. Okay, like here, like you know, while you are developing some code, you know, like this always return Batman. So as instance of, I am converting this into the Batman, but somehow some other developer like me, which have no idea, just trying to fix this bug as soon as possible, because it returns something else. By mistake, I am changing that cast into the Flash, because it's a Friday, I just want to fix that bug and leave from the office. In that case, I am getting, at runtime, while code deploy, at runtime we are getting some exception, because I have no idea about this. But type system actually prevent us for doing that type of mistakes. Okay, so this is why type system is a powerful and important.
There is a problem right here. So only superheroes have power, right? Not the
yes.
There and,
yes. 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 We can. So there. That's why. That's why we have some of the constraints, like variances and bounds. Okay. So what are the variances?
Variance defines inheritance relationship of parameterized types. Variance is all about subtype.
Variance is
actually the main thing. Is variance is all about subtype.
Like as we discussed in like tower of Batman, tower of Hulk, both are different type. Maybe the outer wrapper is same, but inner type is different. And if we are whenever we are seeing these types of syntax, that means we need to consider this as a whole type, not only tower, not only Batman. We need to consider tower of Batman is a single type. Okay, and we know these things, this tower to Batman, this tower to Hulk, both are a different types. Okay, so what are variance? Variance is all about subtyping, because maybe there is a tower of Marvel, there is a tower of Hulk. Actually Hulk and Marvel has some relationship, but if you are talking about in the way of type system, they are different types. So variance resolved that kind of issues where we required inheritance relationship with the parameterized type as well. Okay, variance help us to build the bridge for implementing the inheritance subtyping relationship within a parameterized type, within a generics. Okay. Now, what is the subtyping? We all are familiar with the subtyping. This is just a brief. Subtyping is a conception of a name where denoted instance of many different classes in an object-oriented programming. This is often referred to simply as a polymorphism. Like in a Java, we are as a reference remember we are creating a list equals to a new array list. In a Scala we are doing same kind of things like sequence equals to list, okay, because sequence is super class of list, okay. So subtyping principles, what are the most of us we are familiar with these principles, this scope substitution. The object of super class shall be replaceable with the object of its subclass without breaking the application, okay. If there is a super class object, we can easily replace subclass object. This is called the scope substitution principle, or a subtype polymorphism. Replace an object of type by an object of a subtype is called polymorphism. The same thing, okay. Now but as we discussed, variance is a generic term, but variance has their further types as well: invariant or non-variant, covariant and contravariant, okay. Most of us, I am sure most of us confused with the contravariant, yes or not? But there is really advantages of contravariant. So what are invariants? The class or trait, there is some typo mistakes in our slides, please ignore those typo mistakes. A class or trait that doesn't subtype when that parameter changes, like here marvel as Hulk is a subclass of marvel. But T of Marvel, T of Hulk are a different type. So this is, if like actually Marvel and Hulk is a inheritance relationship, but T of Marvel, T of Hulk doesn't contain any relationship, that is called invariant. That we discussed in our early slides as well, like Tower of Batman, Tower of Hulk, both are different types. Or if there is a tower of Marvel, Tower of Hulk, suppose if our code contains Tower of Marvel, Tower of Hulk, Tower of a Marvel and Hulk contains some relationship because Hulk is a subclass of Marvel. But if they are declaring as a parameterized types, both are different, so those are called invariant or non-variant. This depends on writers. Some of are using invariant, some of are using non-variant, or some of other using no idea.
There is no variance. The invariant is kind of confusing sometimes, right? Because invariant means
there is a variant. Okay.
So when I studied Scala, right?
No relationship. Yes. Invariant means there is no relationship between two types.
So in here is like invisible.
Okay, I have no idea about this.
Non-variant.
So chapter 2 of superheroes, when the superheroes make chills in the tower and enjoy the party with Prathas, Moose and Beers. But at outside, villains start attacking to the innocent people, and for people there is no way for calling the superheroes. So now superheroes has some requirements for installing a landline on their tower for helping the people. So I guess Charan is there. Okay, sorry, share the screen. How can I share this? But we are only able to share only one desktop.
Projector.
indicating kya uska extension de raha hai
the same hai Hello Charan, are you able to see the screen? The screen, just suppose this. Okay, let's move to the invariance. Like here, we are. Yes, yes.
So, as we saw, like, you talked about the type constructor and then the parameterized type. So, what is the difference between these two terms? Or they are.
Type parameterized types is a way for creating your classes as a generics, and the way where you actually declaring this angle brackets is a kind of a constructor for creating a new type.
So that is like we can achieve parameterized types using type.
Yes, you can say that we are achieving parameterized types by using type constructor. Okay. So like here we have a, so is it visible? Code is visible to all of you. So we have a superhero, same hierarchy is always same. Most of the example has the same hierarchy. Okay. So like this tower contains now superhero of T type. Okay. So now like I am just calling tower of Batman, tower of Superman. I am returning the I'm instantiating the object of tower of Batman, tower of Hulk. That's why, that means we have a two towers, which is a tower of Batman type and tower of Hulk type. But and we required a method which is calling to these superheroes. Okay. For that we are getting two separate methods, like because as we know, this tower of Batman is a different from tower of Hulk. Both are different types because they are invariant, non-variant. Okay, both are different types, so that means we need to create a different methods. Okay, so this calling to Batcave contains a parameter type of tower of Batman. This calling to Stark Tower contains a type of tower of Hulk. Okay, so here we are containing a two different methods, and this is a way we are using or declaring non-variant parameterized type or using non-variant parameterized type. Okay, so anyone has a confusion within this example? Anyone has any doubt? This is just a straightforward, because we know there is no relationship between these two types, so that's why we need a different methods. Okay, now what are the problems? Like here we have a different types, but like if I am declaring tower of superhero, because I know superhero is a super type of Batman, every superhero, Marvel, DC, Batman, or whatever he is. So if I am using creating that type of, because don't forget about the dry principle, because both methods contains the same implementation. So if I am trying to declare this type of method, here I am getting the error, because this tower is a non-variant type. There is no relation. Because this tower type is a non-variant type, every type is an independent. Okay, so this is the one of the major problems for a non-variant or a invariant type. Okay, invisible variant. Invisible variant term is, I guess, is a good. Okay, but why we required this invariant? Because we are losing. Because if we are using invariant types, that means we are neglecting the drive principles. Don't repeat yourself. Because we need. That means we need every time we need to create a different type of methods like this, but with same implementation. So what are the benefits of invariant? There are benefits. So is it required to run this program? Or I'm just move forward. Okay, so what are the benefits? So let's, I guess we, most of us have an bit knowledge about a Java. Okay, so if I am looking into this one Java example, then come into the Scala as well. So in Java, our first generic type things are arrays. Okay, so like we are creating a string type of array which contains Iron Man, Hulk, Doctor Strange. I am assigning this comics, this arrays, the string type array to the object array. Okay, and on the zero location, I am replacing the Iron Man to the one, because it is an object array, object is a superclass of every type, and we can do this easily. Okay, and if I am printing this, so what will happen? Anyone have any idea? Sorry? We give a runtime, we get a runtime exception. Why this happens? Because in Java, these arrays are mutable. These arrays are mutable. Like array stored exception. On a zero location, initially we are actually memory allocated for this array is a string, but we are replacing with an int. That's why we are getting an array stored exception. These are kind of variances in arrays, because subtyping are possible in the Java arrays. So if subtyping are possible, we can change this value. That means we are doing some it is possible we are getting these types of exceptions.
This will not happen in Scala.
I'll come to the Scala as well. I'll come to the Scala.
So object is also a super class of everything.
No, but this basically it is a string array. On runtime, when you go and check, so but you are running, you are assigned the reference of string array to an object array, right? And now actually it is a string array, right? Now you are trying to put an int, so it will always be a runtime.
Anuj, if you remember in a starting we had discussed about the weak statically typed language. We are trying to implement that thing here. We are replacing the string bucket with an int at runtime. That's why we are getting the error. That's why Java and Scala is a strong typed languages.
The variable is the object.
It's an object. Object is just a reference. Object is just a remote. Actual thing is this laptop or this slides. Limitation of like variance with the mutable things. Okay, so if I am trying to reflect this example with Scala as well, like here we know like Scala array is backed by Java arrays. So we know Scala, we can Scala arrays are also mutable values because they are backed by Java arrays. So I am frankly doing same thing here. Iron Man of string array and anyref is object type, okay, and like just trying to convert this like in a Iron Man. I am just trying to, I have converted to the, this an array of anyref by using instance of, and I am converting this string array to the anyref array, and on the zero location I am trying to insert anyref. So what will happen here? We are getting the same exception. Okay, this is the reason why we required invariant. This is the reason why Scala arrays are invariant. Sorry, non-variant, invisible variant. Okay, so this is, these are the main benefits. While you are developing a class, creating a class which is a mutable class, or you want to create that class as a parameterized type, in that case you must ensure this class must be the non-variant. Okay, anyone have any doubt? Okay, so we can move forward. Please feel free to ask any question. This is not a just a session. This is the way we are discussing, we are sharing knowledge with each other. Together we learn, together we grow.
Actually, I have one question.
So
we are converting the comics to an instance of array of anyref.
Mm-hmm.
Can we just assign comics directly to object array without converting it to an instance as we do now?
No, it is not possible. Because arrays are in Scala are non-variant. This is not possible. I am just trying to reflect Java example within a Scala here. I am not able to assign 0 here or integer value here because these are invariant. Compiler gave me an error. Bro, this is not possible. This is the power of a strongly typed language or type system. Because this array is of anyref type, this is a non-variant. This is not possible. You can do.
If you write any error, then it will take 1. Then it will take.
Anyref or
anyref. Any, because 1 is the child of
anyref.
It's not child of
anyref. So as we discussed, this is our whole type,
yes.
Array of anyref. Scala arrays are non-variant. Non-variant means maybe your inner types has some relationship. Non-variant, but the whole type means those are independent.
But in this case, anyref is not the superclass owner. The inner type also doesn't have any relationship.
Okay, okay. Just, I guess you are confused with this. Now, yes, 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 yes. I am not breaking the rule of the type.
Right.
Okay. My bad. My mistake. So this is why we are here. This is why we are here, because for sharing knowledge, for clear my doubts as well as your doubts, for discussing. After discussion, we comes with some specified output for learning. That's why we are here. Okay. So.
Yeah,
the actual array into a
array of elements.
You see, basically, as instance of, it's not getting a new array. It is the same array. It is just it has just changed the type.
Type, yes.
It is actually not. It has not created a new array. If it could have created a new array, then it would have been.
And so the objects that it actually contains are not changed.
Okay.
Then the type of array would become any.
So shall we move forward? Okay. Now, what are covariants? Now, anyone have any doubt within the invariant? We all are okay. We all any questions?
So,
yes, yes.
No question.
Yeah, yeah, no problem.
What was the use of non-variant? If I want my array to be generic, like to be of a top class, like of any, so it should accommodate one also.
It should. Yes, this is possible. There are possibility, but with non-variant, somehow you can restrict, like in a Java. Like here, like in this Scala example, I need to manually convert this as instance of something like that.
Because I wrote the line. Why would I create as instance of if I don't want to
you always have a compiler error.
So, it says array to contain some multiple types, but I am not able to.
Yeah.
So, basically,
the answer, yes.
Think of it from the perspective that, for example, array, right? This is just holder of the object. Okay. And it can hold any object. Right? So, I don't want to tie up with a particular relation. What I am saying is, so basically think about generic implementation of array, right? Where it is able to accept any kind of object. Okay. Now, in that case, right, you just want to make sure that whenever you create an array, right, they should be different from, for different objects, it should be a different array.
If I am answering your question, what my understanding is, developer can do anything. Okay, you can use mutable state, you can use immutable states, you can use whatever where, well, whatever. There are some conventions for a good programming practices. But this in non-variant, at some level it restricts us for writing that messed code. Okay, if I am using somewhere, I am using as instance of somewhere else. First, we want to ensure, is it required or not?
So, basically, if I'm getting the gist of references, in Java, I'm not using as instance.
Yeah, as instance of?
So, in Java, it will be a problem.
It will be a problem,
in
yes.
In Scala, it will not be a problem. Because Scala's type systems are
mature than Java. Yes.
So
actually, here we are just forcing.
So, basically, yeah. Java, right? You were able to assign an object array without converting it. But here, what we are specifically saying that array of string is not equal to array of any array. Unless and until you basically do some hack and code it that way. But it will not directly let you assign it.
Yes, sir.
You can, as a instance of, you can do it for, you don't have to even use any, right?
Yes.
Use it for anything. It is not going to check it. Okay, it is just assuming that this may be an object.
Yes, we are forcing. Please do that. Please do that. I am no. Please do that. But in Java, we are not forcing. In Java, this happens by mistakes.
How is
auto boxing
allowed to convert?
No, not
there is no auto box. Auto boxing is a different concept.
So, this is generic. Or you can say array was the first example of generics in Java. So when they introduced generics in 1.6, right? Prior to that, array was the only way where you can basically store different objects in a type of But that was the only thing that Java was very good to generate.
From starting
into
the homogeneous selection, all other selections were of can be of different types.
If you are doing, if you want to some experimenting, you can do often. I'll share definitely share these examples because we have lots of things in our queue. Okay, now you get the you get your answer.
Firstly, how is Scala implementing it? Like, I cannot assign array of any.
Because they are non-variant.
So in Java they are not.
Yeah, in Java we can do, we can write this code by mistake, but here we are enforcing. Here we know, here we knew, like we are enforcefully, forcefully converting this to the this instance. But here we are, here while we are writing this type of code by mistake, we are writing these type of assignments as well.
So Java compiler is not showing anything.
Yes.
But Scala is compiler, it will give me an error.
Because arrays are mutable.
Because
arrays are mutable. We can replace the value, the one memory location with another. We can change the values. Mutable means we can change the values.
No, I'm saying if I'm not using arrays
instance. Then it is not possible.
Then it is not possible. But how Scala is
because Scala using invariant.
Java doesn't have invariant.
Java arrays are variants. Covariants. Java arrays are covariant. Scala arrays are invariant. Under the hood, they are doing the same thing. But for a compile time, for delegating to the compiler, Scala's arrays are non-variant. Java's arrays are covariant. Okay?
So that was first Scala's.
All set? Anyone have any other doubt? So, covariance, a class or trait, then doesn't subtype when the parameter changes. A covariant annotation can be applied to a type parameter or a class or a trait by putting the plus sign before the type parameter. Like here, Hulk is a subtype of Marvel. That means T of Marvel is a subtype of T of Hulk. As we can see in our last problem in the invariant, we have a super type of tower of superheroes, but we are not able to pass Hulk or any other superheroes to that method because our tower type is a non-variant. But we require something like that. So that's why covariants come into the picture. Okay. If we look into the examples, just a minute. So before moving to the covariants of parameterized type, first take in covariant is not a new concept for a type system. Covariant, most of the programming language has a concept of covariance. Covariance or covariant, okay. So like in a Scala and a Java, both has a covariant concept. So without type parameters, where the covariance come into the picture, like here. In this trait, we have a trait called food, okay. Class dog food extends food, okay. Just a simple example, take a simple example. We have an abstract class called animal, okay. And class dog extends animal, that means we need to override abstract method. But that method is actually signature contains def seek food returning a food. But here, what I am doing, I am returning a dog food rather than a food. How is it possible? Because dog food is a subclass of food. And overriding rules say it is possible you can write, you can return subclass of a super type. If your abstract method returning or any method, if you are overriding some method and the super class contains or returning a super type of that method, you can return subtype as well. That pattern is called covariance. So here I am dog, what is dog food here is, what is return type here is, dog food is a covariance return type. From this method I am returning a covariance. Okay. How compiler ensure, why compiler compile this code? Why compiler able to compile this code? Because compiler knows if someone, like here I am creating an animal object, okay, which is a dog type. Compiler knows if someone calling this seek food method and capture in this food reference variable, and I am sure if this returning any subclass, subclass is definitely contains the properties of superclass. Okay, that's why this code is always compiled. If my reference variable is a food type and somehow someone returning a subclass of food, but compiler ensure that subclass definitely contains the properties, the behaviors of superclass. That's why this code is valid. This is called covariance. Anyone have any doubt? Why covariance required? Why compiler compiles this code? Please feel free to ask me any doubt.
But funny how it is related to the generics.
We will come to the generics part. I am trying to clarify the covariance part. But it's covariance. Okay. So first of all, covariance is not a new concept in the programming languages. Dynamic polymorphism. Everything is interrelated with each other. Yes, it is a kind of thing. But type system, the work of type system is on the compiler layer. So why compiler compiles this code? Compiler, because compiler know maybe any subclass, my reference variable is a food type. If any subclass of food assigned to this reference variable, that subclass definitely contains the behaviors and properties of superclass. This way is called covariance. Yes.
Other way is not possible.
Okay. So, I guess I have another case study. I am not sure how interesting these case studies are, but
I have no idea.
So the telephones are installed successfully. Now the people can contact superheroes without any problem. But there is one issue. According to the superheroes, they have different mobiles or phones. So there is a new requirement. I install a single phone for calling the towers, and based on their needs, they can pass the superhero instance to the function and call the appropriate superhero. So the problem we discussed in invariant, the same thing actually here. Like here, now, like same hierarchy, same objects, but now this tower type is of covariant type. We are, even a time system, how we can declare the covariant types by the plus operator. Okay, so now this tower is a parameterized type with covariance type constructor. Okay, and I am this tower class contains T of superhero and the same implementation. Now we are creating a method called calling to the tower. So while this, now this method contains a tower of superhero. Okay, tower of superhero. We are getting a DC and Marvel. Now I am able to pass this tower of DC, tower of Marvel, to this, calling to the tower function, because tower of superhero is a super type of DC and Marvel. Why this is possible? Because of covariance. Okay. Anyone have any doubt? Now this whole
this whole type is actually a super type of this type, this type.
Okay.
But you know, that means like the generics as well, they have a relationship.
We can create the relationship by using variances. We can create the relationship by using variances. Okay. Now take another example. The most common example we are using in our Scala everyday life. We have a, like, if this, we have an option type P and sum of P of P, sum of none of none. So what is this? So these are non-variant parameterized types. If our options are non-variant parameterized types, so what is happening here? I am getting the compile time error. Bro, this is not possible. These are non-variant. You are assigning option of string to option of none. Okay. So how we can resolve this problem? By using covariance. Okay. Now we have a sum of P, option of option is of a covariance type, sum is extend option, and then also also extend option of nothing. Why nothing? Because nothing is a subtype of every type. Now this is possible. If I am creating an option of string, then this is possible. I am assigning a none to the option of string. Okay. If we compile this code, there is no error. So this is the benefit of covariance. Okay.
Plus sign signifies covariant.
If any type contains a parameterized type with the plus, that means that type is a covariance type. Okay.
And this is possible because nothing is a subtype of every type.
Yes, this is possible because nothing is a subtype of every type. Okay. Okay. Now there are some rules of covariance. What are those rules? We most of the time while we are trying to or practicing this generic types, we are getting these types of error, a general error. Covariant types occur in a covariant positions. We generally faces these types of issue. Like if I am copying this code to the REPL, like here I am, box 1 is my covariant type, this parameter, this contains of iFruit parameterized type, and two methods, fruit and contains. So I am using F here, and if I am trying to compile this code, I am getting the error. Why I am getting this error? Because Scala type system is a strict. Because Scala type system knows if you are using this parameter at this level, if you are using covariant type parameter is I am allowing subclasses. We know if I am allowing subclasses at this place, you definitely get an error at runtime. There is a possibility you get an error. We will see why this is possible. But anyone have any doubt? Most common error we are always facing while we are trying to develop or creating a parameterized type classes. Yes or not? This is the most common error. Okay. So why this is possible? Okay. So let's take an example. I have a class abstract, class fruit, class orange which extends fruit, and class apple which extends fruit, def name, def brand like Kashmiri apple, and on a box which contains a box of fruit, fruit returning a fruit, and contains fruit of fruit type. Fruit is a super type of orange and apple. Okay, and I am just calling equals method here. Okay, there is no rocket science within this example. If someone has a problem, please, any issue within this example, please let me know. This is clear. No doubt, no problem. Okay. So concrete way. So suppose I am creating a class like orange box, which accepts orange type parameter and extends box. Okay. And I am writing overriding a method called fruit and orange returning an orange, and this apple and overriding fruit returning an apple. So covariant return type is possible. So we can replace this fruit with an orange, we can replace this fruit with an apple as well. There is no problem. This is simple code, nothing else, nothing new in this code. Okay, so as we know, we are actually repeating the code again and again. We are avoiding we are violating dry principles here, because both of the implementation of apple and apple box and orange box are same. So that's why we are trying to just a minute. So that's why we are trying to create this generic type class, and we also see that this generic class, if we are creating this generic type of class, we are getting an error, contravariant position. Why this happens? Why compiler avoiding following these types of rules? These types of implementation. Okay. Suppose we have a method called with apple brand, and I am it which accepts a fruit, because I know it passes a fruit, and this method is actually specific for the apple brands, because there are several types of apple: Kashmiri apple, Noida apple, Moga apple as well. Okay, so that's why I am converting this fruit to the apple. I know apple is a subtype of fruit, and I am happy apple and just returning a brand of an apple. This code is compiled successfully because this returning an apple and everything is fine. But some developer like me, by mistake, passing, rather than apple, I am passing an orange. It took some time for compiling the code. I guess I'm not sure. Charan is system hang ho raha sir, band kar do record zoom kar. लग नहीं रहा, पार्टिसिपेंट तो दिखा रहा है वो. और आई कैन क्विट द स्लैक फर्स्ट. ओके, सो नाउ इफ आई एम ट्राइंग टू पास द ऑरेंज हियर, I am getting a runtime exception. So that's why compiler not allow to using covariance in that position, because compiler know there is a possibility you can do the mistakes like that. Type system ensure the problems which you are facing on the runtime, most of the problem trying to resolve it at a compile time. So that's why type system doesn't allow to pass this, pass use covariance at the method parameter position. It will never allow, because there is a possibility we can do mistakes like that. Like orange, we are passing orange here, getting a class cast exception. That's why this is the reason. Anyone have any doubt why compiler restrict us? Okay, so like here, but it allows to using this covariance at return type. Like here, I am creating a box of apple, I am creating a box of orange which returns a fruit 1, fruit 2. And like why this compiles, like this code is compiled, if I am compiling this code, स्टॉप करना पड़ेगा सर, बहुत हैंग हो रहा है सिस्टम. पूछ लेता हूँ उससे. रिकॉर्डिंग के कारण प्रॉब्लम. खैर हम नॉलेक्स वे से रिकॉर्ड तो कर ही रहे हैं. So why this code is compiled? Compiler, while we are using covariant at a return type, compiler allows to compile this code. Why this is possible? We see this example in our earlier example. We see the reason in our earlier example as well, because compiler knows if you are using super reference variable at catching the object at runtime. There is no at runtime, because compiler ensure if we are passing any subclass in this method, like this returning a fruit type, and I am returning a subclass of this orange and apple. If I am declaring this box of fruit, or this method returning like orange or apple, then this doesn't make sense. This doesn't create a problem, because compiler knows fruit is a super type of everything, and every subclass definitely contains the properties or behaviors of its super type. So that's why compiler allowed to use covariant type parameter into the return type of position, but not to the parameterized type of position. And why this allow as a class parameter as well? The one reason of it allows the class parameter, because Scala variables and methods both share the same namespace. You can override a variable, a class variable, by using method as well. So variable ifruit f means, if I am trying to override, suppose it is a val, this is a public. Public variable we can override by methods as well. So if I am trying to override ifloat by method, at that case f is my return type. So that's why Scala compiler allows to use this covariant into the parameters position as well. Okay. That I want to explore, but there is a possibility. Yes. No. I guess no. Yes, sir, he is right actually, because the scope of this without val variable within this brackets only. If you decompile this code, this parameters comes into the your constructor.
Yeah, all the whole body is the constructor.
Yes, all the body.
So to the constructor, it will take.
So we are saying that, for example, the class has three members, and I have four parameters in my constructor.
Primary constructor without val.
So basically, it's not a case class. In case class, these are members because they are valves.
Okay, now you have an idea?
So, I have one question.
Yes.
So, in the previous example, so we were talking about like the grad the apple with grad where we were passing the image. So, that was basically filling at runtime, right?
Yes.
Not at the compiler.
Yes. So, this is what type system advantage is. Type system advantage is he's trying to avoid those problems which is most common occur at runtime. The main purpose of type system is resolve those issues which most of the issues which occurs at runtime. Compiler knows this all depends on developer. Okay, but compiler knows if you are using a type system. Okay, if you are doing something like that, if you are allowing covariance parameter as a method parameter, then there is a possibility, maybe 1% possibility. There is a possibility some developer do the same mistake.
Okay, otherwise, 44 like replace the replace variable into val myFloat is equal to iFloat dot
an
instance of.
But it never allows. Compiler never compile if your method parameters containing the covariance parameter. Compiler never allow. Compiler never ever allowed to doing that kind of programming, that kind of method declaration. But this is a return type. If I am trying to use like here, now I'm getting an error. This is the power of type system. He's trying to avoid those mistakes which most of the developers are performing at runtime. The main purpose of type system is avoid to occur those errors which are most common or generated at runtime. We are delegating those checks to the compiler. Compiler, yeah, please do this check for me. Compiler, no, yeah, if you are doing this type of issue, there may be the possibility. There is a 1% chance. If there are no generics, if there are no parameters, we are writing method like this way and enforcing this instance of Apple. We know, because I am writing a code, I know pretty well. But still there is a 1% chance some other developer, or by mistake, or like IntelliJ is ever like mature. By mistake, like IntelliJ give me a suggestion as an orange. By mistake, I am entering orange. What? Today is a Friday. Push the code to the GitHub production, and I am enjoying one party, and at 1 a.m. I am getting a pager duty.
compiler
itna smart hai to definitely you are getting some error.
Haan nahi
you can do something like that. I don't know, maybe this depends on my logic. Maybe you can do something like that, instance of some type. Okay, let's try to just a minute.
45th line.
Which one?
45th line.
45th. Here. Class cast exception, definitely we are getting because as instance of work at a runtime. That's the brand is here because user doesn't contain a value of brand. We are bypassing the compiler by using as instance of. करने को हम कुछ भी कर सकते हैं बट सपोज आई एम कॉलिंग सम थर्ड पार्टी सर्विसेज फ्रॉम हियर आई एम कॉलिंग डेटाबेस फ्रॉम हियर
मेथड स्पेसिफिक
करते हो ही मेथड नहीं इनपुट मिलता आपने जो देयर इज अ पॉसिबिलिटी लाइक हियर दिस इज करंटली आई डोंट हैव मच ऑफ द एग्जांपल्स बट दिस इज वन ऑफ द रीजन दिस इज कंपाइलर सेड दिस इज द पॉसिबिलिटी दिस इज द वन ऑफ द रीजन यू आर लाइक इन सपोज यू आर यूजिंग सम एज इंस्टेंस ऑफ currently I have only this as instance of example why compiler not allowing to use parameters within here because I am trying to if in the method performing these types of issue there is a possibility we are getting some this type of exception but there are some other parameters as well which I am not aware about all of the parameters honestly I am not aware about the all of the parameters because type level programming type level system type level programming itself is huge broad term huge concepts are there but somewhere we need to trust on the compiler ki yaar if compiler doesn't allow to me for performing these types of issue, there are some reasons. One of the reason is like here we are discussing, but there are some other reasons which I am not aware about all of the reason. Maybe we can together we will find other reasons as well. But currently I have these reasons, this only one reason. Yes, yes, you can. Yes.
So, box have a C type, no? And so clearly this will not compile if we save F method R of type B. A variance error for correct? Now, when we say ki a type A is a subtype, ye relationship to iska matlab ye ki A ke bare mein jitni properties provable hai wo sab B ke bare mein bhi hongi provable. So let's just say ki ye isme ek do properties hai iska provable, to iske upar bhi ye to provable hongi, iske maan lo do teen aur extra hai. Now if we are in this paradigm, then we will have ki jo box of A hai, it is also some type of box of B. ठीक. Now जो जो चीजें इस पे वाले जो जो प्रॉपर्टी इस पे पूरे वाले वो भी इस पे भी होनी चाहिए. Now अगर हमने बोला कि this method should be able to accept an argument of type P, तो मतलब इसका जो method है it should be able to operate on a value of type A. Now when we say the same thing here, then we by the subtyping ये method भी A पे operate करना चाहिए. ठीक है, but ये चीज़ हो नहीं सकती क्योंकि
but वो contravariance means इस तरह vice versa.
So currently we have a one example here why this not allow, compiler not allow.
So maybe he's trying to say like there's a method, there's a super class which will have which will work for something. Then or if super class will also work for all these statements. Like there's a class called true, it can work on three statements which a def method has. So all the subclasses of fruit will also compile or work for all these steps which my method has.
So this explanation mein like now if we ye cheez hum yahan pe dekhe to ye iska jo method hai wo b type ki value pe operate karna chahiye, but by this relationship it should also be able to operate on value of type a, but it is not possible because it hierarchy mein upar aata hai. So that's why this method can operate on all types which are iske niche jo, बट अगर हम ये रिलेशनशिप बोल रहे हैं तो वो ए के ऊपर भी ऑपरेट करना चाहिए, इसलिए ये कॉन्ट्रावेरिएंट पोजीशन है. अगर मेथड का आर्गुमेंट है तो वो कॉन्ट्रावेरिएंट है. तो अगर हम मेथड फंक्शन टाइप्स में अगर सब टाइपिंग देखें तो वो मतलब माइनस देना पड़ता है फंक्शन टाइप को. तो सो आई मीन इज इट क्लियर लाइक व्हाई 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 ये मतलब कंपाइलर एरर शो करेगा. आई मीन इट विल नॉट कंपाइल. नहीं
प्लीज एक्सप्लेन
अगेन. अच्छा तो लेट्स जस्ट से कि ये चीज क्लियर है कि अगर ए मतलब बी ए का सबटाइप है तो ए पे जितनी चीजें प्रोबेबल हो सब बी के ऊपर भी प्रोबेबल होनी चाहिए. अब हमने बोला बॉक्स ए बॉक्स बी का सबटाइप, बॉक्स बी बॉक्स सी का सबटाइप है, तो जो जो चीजें यहाँ पे हो सकती हैं वो चीजें यहाँ पे भी हो सकती हैं. अच्छा क्या क्या चीजें यहाँ पे हो सकती हैं? ये जो मेथड है ये इस टाइप का आर्ग्यूमेंट देना चाहिए कि यहाँ पे मेथड ए टाइप के आर्ग्यूमेंट को सक्सेसफुली ऑपरेट उसके ऊपर ऑपरेट कर सकता है. यहाँ पे क्या कि ये इसका जो मेथड ये बी टाइप के आर्ग्यूमेंट को ऑपरेट कर सकता है. अब क्योंकि हमने इन दोनों टाइप में सबटाइपिंग रिलेशनशिप लगाई है तो मतलब ये जो मेथड है वो ए पे भी ऑपरेट करना चाहिए. सो अगर हम इस मेथड को एक ए टाइप की वैल्यू दे तो फटना नहीं चाहिए, बट फटेगा क्योंकि ए टाइप ए ऊपर है. तो कुछ ऐसी चीज़ें हो सकती हैं जो कि हमने मतलब बी के ऊपर की हैं बट वो ए के ऊपर नहीं हो सकती.
बट वो मोस्टली डिक्लेयर तो ए के लिए हुआ है. मतलब अगर बॉक्स को डिक्लेयर करोगे तो ए के लिए डिक्लेयर.
इफ आई एम डिक्लेयरिंग अ बॉक्स ऑफ बी
तो देन इट विल वर्क फॉर बी एंड सी एंड सो ऑन फॉर इट्स सबटाइप. आई एम आस्किंग मतलब आई एम सेइंग
it's working for, I've declared it for A. Like box of A with covariance. This is the situation, right? Declared box of A with covariance. So A, B ke liye work kar raha hai, but aap input nahi le pa rahe ho, B type, matlab generic type ka. Theek hai? So is case mein kya ho raha hai ki aapne, main sirf bol raha hu ki aapne A ke liye wo kiya hai box. A ke liye box banaya hai, to jo method hai, usme A gaya hoga. So jahan pe aapne A ke liye banaya hai, wo B ke liye bhi provable hoga. तो B के लिए specific method अलग ही बनेगा जो A के लिए provable नहीं होगा. वो method बनाया केवल A के लिए. ये वाली तो theory नहीं लगेगी. कुछ और ही हुआ है.
Okay. So maybe.
अच्छा एक और
time. Maybe not yet.
अच्छा ठीक चलो बात.
Maybe while we are seeing contravariance, maybe the picture comes to the more clear way. But this is the one of the reason which we discussed. Now there are possibility, there are chances if someone writing that type of code within your method behavior, there is a possibility we are getting the errors. Okay, okay, now next one is contravariance. The class of a trait then subtype contravariantly in the opposite direction as a type annotated parameter. The contravariant annotation can be applied to a type parameter of a class or trait by putting minus sign before the type parameter, like here. So it says,
can you go to the covariance?
Yes, sir, sure. In my box. Where is my box? Yes. Method or a variable? List of only fruit or apple, orange. Okay, apple, orange. Abstract
list of it. Fruit of it.
Like this? Just a minute, just a minute. Create a function called add. Okay.
And in this, we are passing f as a parameter, right? It will not allow.
Yes, yes. Box of an apple, yes.
Okay. And agar ye allow karta hai yahan pe, to in apple, to in because of this variant, right, you will be able to add any other
fruit, sir.
So list of apples mein orange bhi add ho jata
hai. Orange, right?
Kyunki hum dekhte hain matlab run time mein bata rahe hain ki ye is type par list nahi hai. But hum compiler ka parallel statement mein orange ke liye response.
Yes. So if we are getting a box of apple, then there is a possibility we can add the in this back apple box, we can add oranges as well. So that's why it actually not, but if we are getting an apple, but this is the list of apple, but if we are getting a
box, you are taking it to the F, right? The box of apple will be apple,
box of yes.
But you would be able to add food, right? Because food will contain the property of
ambiguity. Agar aap list of food banate ho to aap dono add kar sakte ho. Agar list of apple banate ho to aap
ek hi
add kar sakte ho. Theek hai, to ye matlab teen condition rahegi, isme do fail honge. Jahan pe different types aa rahe hain, ek hi rahegi jahan pe list of food banaya aapne, usme aap dono add kar sakte ho. List of apple banaya usme ek hi add kar sakte ho aur list of orange banaya usme ek hi add kar sakte ho. To in dono cases mein aapki exception aayengi agar aap dusre type add karna chahoge aur jahan pe food list banaya hai wahan pe chale.
Function is a function. But there is a case. There is a case we will see in the contravariance. Okay, so I am sure we are concluding some of the things here. Why compiler not allowed to add covariance within a parameter? First of all, maybe there is some developers like maybe forcefully converting this into the this. Okay, and the second one is like if we are creating a box of apple only, then there is no way to adding other fruits within that box. Okay, so
that's
why actually if we these variances like plus minus covariance contravariance are mostly referred to use mostly used for building a container type classes. Mostly use container type classes. If we need to specify some inheritance type relationship, then the type parameters come into the picture, lower bounds, upper bounds. But these variances are used mostly for the container type classes. You can do the same thing with the type bound. Like here we are performing the same thing with the type bound as well. So there are use cases. The type bound is the best for the inheritance type relationship, and these variances are best for the building a container type class. That we will see in our module 2. Okay, so this is actually most of the writers said like now T of Marvel is a subclass of Hull, which is actually for the code perspective, which is actually true. But conceptually, it is not a true. Hulk is a subclass of Marvel, so that's why compiler allowed to pass a Hulk parameter like a contravariance, like a method containing the Hulk. That's why compiler allowed to pass Marvel to the parameter. But this looks like a Marvel is a subclass of Hulk, but it is not a true. This only allows because Hulk is a subtype of Marvel. Why this? We will see in the examples and what are the benefits as well. So first of all, let's take an example of a contravariance first. Okay. Yes. So same, we have a abstract class superhero Marvel, and we have a four subclasses like Doctor Strange, Hulk, Iron Man, and Thor. And there is one fan club. S class fan club T. So because of the popularity of superheroes, now people build a fan club, and every Marvel have a superhero has their own fan club, and every fan club provides their own benefits like 50% discount on Doctor Strange movie, 40% discount on Hulk movies. Hulk fan club provide like Iron Man fan club provide 60% discount on Iron Man movies, but Thor fan club provide 55%. So we are creating a Doctor Strange fan club, Hulk fan club, and Doctor Strange fan club passed a object. This Doctor Strange fan club, we are only passable to Doctor Strange type object, like here. Okay, and Hulk fan club, we can pass only Hulk because these are non-variant. We are not able to pass this Hulk fan club to Doctor Strange fan club because it contains 50% discount on Doctor Strange movie. Okay. So there are limitations. Like I am not able to fan like me. I like all the superheroes. I like Batman as well, Superman as well. So how we conclude that? So as I added this case study, like fan club, creating a fan club and purchase the tickets. But the problem is, for those fan clubs, some of the fans are really happy, but most of them are really disappointed because some of the like Marvel movies as well, DC as well, and other superheroes as well. So they want discounts, but what can they do? Because everyone has their own fan club. So that's why they actually created one community, like a fan club community, which actually creates a method which allow us to, like, if you are a Marvel fan, then we are giving you a generic discount. For all superheroes movies, we are giving a generic discount. How is it possible? Like, this fan club is now a contravariance fan club. Contravariance means if there is a Hulk fan club, we can pass Marvel as well. We can pass superheroes as well. Like here, we have a Doctor Strange fan club, Hulk fan club, Iron Man fan club, Thor fan club, and we are creating a different objects of fan club. Like this is a Doctor Strange fan club object. Like some of the Marvel fans have a Marvel fan club, superheroes fan club. So if anyone required, if like I am a fan of a Marvel, okay, I want to see all the Doctor Strange, Hulk, Iron Man movies, so I can easily get discount from any of the fan club. Okay, this is possible because this fan club is now contravariant. So now for a Doctor Strange, if fan club is a fan club of Doctor Strange, I can pass Marvel fan club as well. Yes.
Same level,
yeah. We can't. Okay. So this is called contravariance. This allow us to pass. If we required some of the generic type things, this allow to pass this thing. This is called contravariance. Okay. So anyone has any doubt in the contravariance? Why this allow? This only allows because of subtyping rules, because compiler knows if a parameter, like if it is a Hulk type and I am allowing to pass super type because I forget about it, one thing. Maybe in the rules of contravariance we will discuss this part. So another thing, in a Java, C++, Scala, they are not allowing contravariant parameters. We are not, if we are without type system, if we are getting a simple method, it doesn't allow to pass super type as a method parameter. But some other languages has the properties of contravariance as a core language feature as well. Not only type system feature, but core language feature. But JVM based languages doesn't allow to do something like that, contravariance type. Okay. So now, like here, we are having a fruit, orange extends fruit, and apple extends fruit as well. So the box has a method called contains, which takes a type parameter t, okay, and returning it takes a parameter t because it is a contravariant type. But here I am getting an error. Anyone have any idea? We discussed that part. But why I am getting an error? We already discussed this thing in a contravariance position. Because this is a public field, we can override this as a method, and method return type is only allow covariance, not contravariance. Got it? Why method return type is not allow contravariance? Why? Because if the return type, if a method, I am overriding a method, first returning a apple, now second time I am returning a fruit, new fruit, super type expecting reference variable of apple type, and apple has its own feature, but fruit doesn't contain this own feature. So that's why for the return type position we are not allowing contravariance. So why we are getting this error? Because this is a public field and it is possible to override this field as a method, and in that case this T is a return type. But if I am doing like this, now here I am getting the error, but this is possible because compiler knows the scope of this variable within the braces only. Okay. Now the rule is, why compiler allows to us a contravariant here? Okay, just this is the first thing. Why compiler allow? Because compiler knows here I am forget something, the point. Where? Like here? No, we can't, I guess.
We cannot.
Because contravariance, the reason of contravariance is mostly with the function variance. The reason of contravariance is not for this perspective. The reason of contravariance for a type function type perspective that we will see in our next slides. This is one of the reason.
Okay,
A fruit. No, this is not possible.
So basically, what we are saying is to talk about previous example, right? So in a function, okay, so when I am calling a function, okay, so let's say I am calling a function for apple. Okay, I have created this box of apple, right? And the function can contain, so I am passing an apple there, right? In the previous example, okay, in case of covariant, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So instead of apple, in a function, right, I can pass a super class of apple, right?
Yes.
So apple ki jagah main food bhi pass.
Food bhi pass. Yes.
Okay. And now this food can be of any type, right?
Any type.
Orange type.
Yes.
Okay. So you would not be able to. Then I do not have a box of apple, but I would have a box of orange as well, right? Just clearing the previous example, why you were not able to allow it in the function. Okay. Now here, if you see, I can pass a super type, right? Okay, so in function, I can just pass a fruit. Okay, I can keep passing a super class of fruit, right? Which is going to be, what is it? Fruit super class.
Nuts.
प्लांट
एंड
लेकिन यहाँ पे मैं अगर मैं टाइप को लेता हूँ सब टाइप को तो आई कैन नॉट असाइन फ्रूट टू एप्पल राइट मेरा जो एप्पल है इट कैन नॉट बी फ्रूट बिकॉज़ एप्पल हैज मोर प्रॉपर्टीज तो तुमने अगर यहाँ पे एप्पल बनाया है तो यहाँ पे तुम फ्रूट पास नहीं कर सकते राइट एप्पल इज नॉट
लाइक हियर
उसके अंदर वो वाली प्रॉपर्टीज तो होंगी
ना मतलब कुछ स्पेशल है कि इससे तो क्या होगा ऐसे मतलब स्पेशल टाइप की स्पेशलाइजेशन है सब क्लास तो ये जो है मोर प्रॉपर्टीज लाइक वो की प्रॉपर्टी एक्स्ट्रा है वो मैं कॉल कर रहा हूँ फंक्शन में और अगर उसके सुपर
टाइप बट द थिंग इज हियर इफ यू आर यूजिंग कॉन्ट्रा वेरियंट ऑफ टी टाइप ना देन इट ओनली अलाउज टू कॉल सुपर क्लास मेथड नॉट अ स्पेसिफिक मेथड्स इट नेवर अलाउ लाइक फॉर अस फॉर हियर फॉर टी फॉर एवरी टाइप वी नो एन इज अवर सुपर टाइप दैट पार्ट इज क्लियर सो इट ओनली अलाउज इफ वी आर यूजिंग कॉन्ट्रावेरियंट पोजिशन हेयर सो द कंपाइलर ओनली अलाउ टू कॉल सुपर क्लास मेथड्स नॉट स्पेसिफिक टाइप मेथड्स So that's why it allows to. Yes. You can't access any specific method. So that's why it allows to use this parameter type T. But contravariant is not meant for this perspective. This is just for understanding. This is the features contravariants have. The contravariant perspective is. For building a function types for the lambda's expression okay for the lambda's expression for the function type there is a possibility that you can hack anything you can hack contravariant you can hack covariant that depends on the developer but if we are trying to build a good application this type system allow us to or make us code more clear more like generic strict You are not doing the mistakes again and again. We can crack anything. There is nothing to possible to crack anything. There is no hard and fast rule. If any language has some hard and fast rule, that means that language is going to be doomed. हो ही नहीं सकता. अगर language इतनी flexibility नहीं देगी ना, the language going to be doomed. Possible ही नहीं है. कोई बंदा उसमें develop करेगा ही नहीं. Because The real life scenarios are different from the language perspective. Sometimes we need to try to hack some things. Some of the libraries contain the hacks, but that smaller hacks build your libraries more faster, more suitable. Okay, so we trying to understand the concepts. This is possible. This is not. But still there are backdoor entries for hack anything. Okay. So if we are using contravariant as a parameter position, it only allows to call the super type method, any methods, not a specified type methods. Okay. So these are the rules of contravariance. Why it is aligned here without val? Because this is in the specific scope. This we are not able to override this a fruit. Okay. So now anyone have any doubt? Okay. Let's move to the function variance, Scala function variance. If we use generic type method, the input parameter needs to be more general, and the output type parameters need to be more specific. The same thing. Input type parameters, function variance, function. What is a function? We have a lambda expression. Functions are a type in a Scala. functions are function 1, function 2, function 3, function 4 are types into Scala, and function 1 means one input, one output. Function variance means the input is a more generic. More generic means contra variance. Like here, we have a function 1 which accepts Hulk as an input, movie as an output. Accepts parameter as an Hulk, return movie as an output. And we can pass Marvel as a parameter and romantic as a return type. So function 2 is a subtype of function 1. The rules are same. Rules are same. Function parameters are always contravariance. Return types are always covariance. Rules are same. This is called function variance. Okay. Any question here? Shall we move for the examples? Nowadays, the popularity of superhero movies moving to the peak point, and people are really enjoying their fan clubs and movies discounts as well. And because of that, now channel decide to create a survey of movies and decide to broadcast their popularity on their channel. As we know, most of the news channels are now. If unke paas koi news nahi hai, then they are going to be a movies part or surveys or popularity as well. So let's create an example on the basis of that. So like here we have a same hierarchy, but now we have a trait called movie, which contains a method called description, and a case class called romantic movie and action movies, so which accents movie. Now I am creating a method which is in a higher order function, which accepts a function type parameter which takes Hulk and returning a movie. Okay, here I am creating the F of Hulk of Avengers. Okay, now I am creating a Marvel movie, which is a input type is a Marvel and return type is a movie, and here I am passing action of this Marvel is an input parameter and action is a it's an action movie. Okay, then I am returning an object of action. So if I am passing this parameter, this Marvel movie to this release movie is a type of Hulk and movie. This is a subtype of this movie. Or we can also like here action. If we compile this code, we compile. This is what it is. This is a function variance. This Hulk of movie is a sub super class super function of Marvel of action. The rules are same. So there are possibilities why we are using creating higher order functions. There are possibility we need to perform these kinds of action. At that time, contra variance actually come into the picture. Okay, so take another example. So we are having a release movie, which is a super movie, and returning a movie. And here I am creating a Batman movie. But while I am trying to pass this, the superheroes actually using the Hulk. But here I am trying to pass in the Batman. If compiler allow this passing this Batman, this covariance parameter to the function, this covariance to the function parameter, then here I am getting the errors at runtime. यार आई एम पासिंग द बैटमैन बट दिस फंक्शन परफॉर्मिंग ऑन अ हल्क. I guess now we are getting some picture why contra variance allow this method parameter position. Like here I am, if I am trying to do this, I am getting compile time error because compiler knows, bro, you are doing something wrong. This is a contra variance position. I am not allowing to do this. If compiler allows to pass in this, I am getting some error at runtime, or my method behavior is different. My method behavior performs on hulk, but I am passing Batman. I guess now we have an idea. If I am passing, okay, shall we move to the next example? Okay, like here we have a foo of x of any which returning a string, any of string, and bar, and we have another method bar which we are foo of, which we are calling here foo of passing x. Everything's running fine, but with function traits there is a possibility, if I am trying to do this here, it doesn't allow me because these are the methods, these are the functions. In a method there is a possibility, these are not a generic methods, that's why we are allowing, that's why compiler allowed to do this. But we are getting a, these are not generic method, that's why there is a possibility we are getting some problem. But Scala function is a typed, is a type of generic type parameter, that's why it doesn't allow to perform in these types of operation, because there is a possibility compiler know there is a possibility you can do something like that. So first of all, methods and types are methods and function types are both are different. Methods are associated with the objects, types are associated with the heap, or types itself is a type, like our custom types int, float, double, user, address. So function 1, function 2, function 3 is a type. Okay, so with the functions we are not able to something like that because they are generics, because compiler know if you are using generics then I am not allowing to do this something like that, because there is a chances for creating some issues within your code. But if you are not using generics, this depends on you, you can do anything. Okay, so these are the reasons why contravariance or covariance. But we're just trying, I'm just trying to figure out whatever I figure out regarding contravariance, covariance, I'm just trying to discuss here. Okay. Yes.
You're not calling anything.
Yes, I'm not calling anything. This is a generic type function trait. If you want to see the Scala function state. Like, as we know, first parameter is a argument type, last parameter is a return type. So that's why.
But
yes, but compiler no. Yes, we. ये एग्जांपल सिर्फ इसलिए है कि if we are trying to do something like that, if you are creating a function generic type which is any or string, okay, it doesn't allow to do something like that. Yes. These are the non-variant and these are the non-variant. It allows. I'm sure here I'm missing something. Which definitely when I actually there is an example. There is some issue with this example here. But why this is not compiled? Because these are non-variant. Why this is not compiled? Because these are non-variant. Because this arc and return type is a non-variant parameter. Why you are confused? Non-variant is account not compiled. There is a actually here in this example I am missing something definitely. I'll let you know while I am exploring this more, but there is some missing points here. Actually, I am forget about those points. That was my mistake. I don't want to compare this to the functional trait. Yes. But the Scala traits which function on function 2 is actually major used contravariant types. Major output is a covariant. Okay. So still variance is not only solution. There are still problems with variance. What are those problems? Like here, I am creating a. This is actually not compiled code. This is not compiled code. Like, still, if. Here I am creating. I guess this example going to be messed. I'll share the another problem with you. Like here I am. Like if you look into this hierarchy in our example, we are having the superhero, we are getting a generic type, but this superhero is actually contain a property team. Okay, if I am trying to use this property, there is no property. I am passing the superhero in this tower object. I know the superheroes contain a scheme property, but I am not able to access this property. Yes. So this is the problem with the variance.
We have to any
yes. This is not the only solution. Variance is not the only solution. So there is another way, which is called bounds. Yes. So this is the main limitation of variance. Why variances are not into the picture. Okay, so bounds are within a second module. We will discuss after lunch, I guess. Okay. So I hope you enjoyed the session.